and welcome to Design Education Talks, the collaboration between the New Art School and Design Deducts podcast. Our guest today is Joost Rosenkrantz. Welcome, Joost.
Hello, hello. Thanks for having me.
It's a real pleasure.
Go for it.
It's a real pleasure. So tell us about you and your work.
Okay. I've been trained as a graphic designer, I went to night school, actually. So I was actually working in design studios for 5 years during the daytime and studying at nighttime. And that was before I was educated as a more technical designer, so more skill-driven. So that was why this was possible. But I actually am over 30 years already in the design profession, which is quite some time, 35 years if you add up the 5 years during night school with it. And over the last few years, I've developed a passion for education. So slowly I'm moving towards education more and more. My roots are from the Netherlands. So I'm born in the Netherlands. Currently I'm living in Den Haag, The Hague, which is a small city next to the sea. And I've been working all together for about 18 years in the Netherlands. But I've also had some experience abroad, because I lived in London for 2 years. This was in the late 90s, where I was working for the Guardian newspaper, still one of my favorite newspapers. They were quite ahead already with developing an online newspaper, and I was then responsible for helping them to design this newspaper online, which was a very steep learning curve for me, because I hadn't even had email by that time, so I had to learn a lot, so that was fantastic. Also, I did 1 year of freelance in London, and what I got from that was that it was quite an eye-opener to be able to look into the kitchen of many different design studios, from small to big, and to see how they organize themselves, how they communicate, how they deal with creativity, even in large scale, that it can sometimes be a challenge. So went back to Holland, and later on I moved to China for about 10 years, and I just moved back more than a year ago. So to put it really short, I've been working for 9 different design studios over the years, and also for 4 different universities. One of them was in China. And I co-founded and owned 2 design studios myself. One was in the Netherlands, that started in 2001 for 8 years. I started that together with friends that I had met at a previous design studio. And later on, 2012, I started Sparky Tiger, my design studio in Shanghai, together with a Chinese designer that was. And it actually all started, my professional work all started in the early 90s, just after my graduation. I started working then at Studio Damwar. I was also super proud to go work there, because I was always looking up to them. So this was just out of art school, and the timing was very fortunate for me as well, because when I stepped in, there was a design competition kicking off for redesigning the logo for the Dutch police. There was a merger going on between 2 police forces. And I was pitching as one of the designers of Studio Damwar, and I also won that pitch, luckily. So that meant that for 2 years I was working on this project. That was kind of a fantastic start. Is it interesting to say a bit more about that project?
Yes, please. Yes, please. That's really good. Yes, please.
Okay. Yeah, so the request was, the pitch was for, or the competition was to redesign the logo, and that's what we did. But I think, looking back, the design for the cars, the vehicles, actually also used on boats and on helicopters and airplanes, all these things, but mostly cars and motorbikes, is that this was even more important, and this was going beyond the logo. So a pattern of diagonals was developed. And that was kind of, and that still is a very visible and recognizable thing if you go to Holland. I think many people that have visited here probably might memorize that, because they're quite visual. And the reason is that why they are very visual is they have 2 colors, which is a fluorescent orange for visibility during the day and a reflective blue for visibility during the night. So in day and night situation, you can see the car very well also. All the cars are white, and that was a very practical reason. They had 140 different models. And to keep it simple and also affordable, they only have 1 color standardized for every different car brand, and that's the white. And white is a very visible color anyway, so we use that. And with one plastic bag with these fluorescent and reflective diagonals, you could transform any white car into a police car. So it was kind of a one-size-fit-all solution.
Fantastic.
That also saved a lot of artwork after. You just had a simple instruction. And these diagonals are mostly glued on the front side of the car. And there's one reason for that is that every car has front doors, not necessarily back doors. You can open the front doors and then you can have like a visual roadblock. So if there's an accident or something urgently happening on the street, they can just place the car on the street and use it as a visual screen. Well, the looks are super simple, and it is in a way, but it took like at least half a year to develop it and test it. Mm. But and it's still in use after, what is it now, 30 years or so. So it was kind of a wild kickoff of my early career, actually, to get to be involved in a project like that. It was quite exciting.
Fantastic, fantastic. So tell us, how did you get into teaching?
I got into teaching by actually when I was in Shanghai, because in Shanghai, I moved there in 2009, and the first 4 years I was working as a creative director for a studio done by China. They were already based there, so the studio was already up and running. And after 4 years, I stopped there, and the last 5 years of my 10 years in China, I got involved in design education because I was asked by a contact I had from the Netherlands. And this was exciting in the sense that this was an international design education, and it was just kicking off. So they didn't have any curriculum yet, so it was all at the beginning. So we started with only year one, and then gradually it was building up. An international design education, it was a strange hybrid, something you don't find in the West, but there was a government-owned and a privately owned institute that were merging together in order to make this education possible. And what they did was they invited masters. They call them masters, kind of a Chinese way of identifying people that have a big track record in their professional life. So all people with creative backgrounds, but very diverse. Also stage playing and flamenco guitar, but also a lot of design. They were invited to come over to either open a studio in China or an educational program or a mix of the two. So I was invited by a Dutch designer called Michel de Boer and a quite famous Chinese designer called Wang Min. And I was kind of jumping on their train and helping them to establish this education that was specialized in branding, identity, and public space design, with only Chinese students from 18 till 22 on average. And it was an English-spoken program, lucky me. but there was always a translator in the room. So the first 2 years, the education was done with interpretation. Mm. And the second 2 years, the students had to be fluent enough to do it by themselves.
Oh, that's quite a challenge doing it by interpretation. I have done some teaching like that, and it's tricky.
It can be tricky, but in the last 3 years, I had a fantastic translator that sometimes you get a click with someone.
Yes,
you're
yes.
really a great team. That's important then.
So you've taught in China and you've taught in Holland. So how would you describe the challenges or the differences between these countries?
Yeah, of course, there are quite a few differences. Of course, the topic is the same. But the differences are, I'm now teaching in Holland at an art school in the Netherlands, in the middle of the Netherlands. And what you generally can say is that Dutch students, they are more outspoken because they kind of tell you like, yeah, we think you should do it differently because our experience is like this, and they like to go and have a discussion with you, which is in one way or another more effective because then you immediately find out like, okay, they already know this or they think they have other ideas, and we can together think of the best solution. So it's more of a dialogue in a way. And they are more outgoing. Another thing is that students are also not so scared to make mistakes. And I think making mistakes is a very integral and important part of being a designer, not being a design student only, but also a professional designer, because by trying out, you find new ways, right? So, there's some of the things, some of the things to overcome in China were sometimes culturally driven, because for instance, the education in China is, I would say, very competitive compared with Europe. And the reason is that there's many universities, but even more students. So how do you manage that? They all want to get in because this is their way to a better life. Only a few have access to learning. And of course, learning, studying in China is already stressful because they have to learn the language that is a complicated language. It's not like with an alphabet that you have to learn the shape of the character has a meaning, and it also has a sound, and it can be pronounced in four tone heights. So this is what kids all have to learn. My son is learning this as well at the moment, and it's really a struggle because, so in general, I would think that education is perceived as something difficult. It's not something you enjoy really. So that's also a bit the mindset of Chinese students. The other thing is, I mean, I'm generalizing it. Of course, there's exceptions.
Of course.
There's many only children, so there's a lot of pressure from parents that they have to do well because there's only one that can do well. And the other thing is that because they have to get into university, they have to have high scores. So the only thing that in general universities look at is that if a student has many high scores, but the tricky thing with design is that there are so many qualities that you cannot score. You know that as well as an educator. So what about creativity and empathy and curiosity or critical thinking and collaboration skills? These are all things that are really hard to measure. So in our education, which was actually a very small one, and that was also an advantage, we interviewed also the students, but that is an exception, I know, in China. And there's many other things, because China is very craft-driven. They really appreciate craft, but the ideation part, making ideas, is something that is not really developed yet in education. I actually wrote kind of an extensive lessons learned after 4 years teaching in China that I posted on my LinkedIn. So there's more to say about it. But yes, the differences are quite big, I have to say.
Fantastic. Tell us, how do you bring the lessons learned from your career in London as a student at Dunbar into your education?
The way I do it is mostly just by, I'm not someone that is going to study deeply. Of course, I use all kinds of resources available wherever, online most of the times, but it's mostly driven by my personal experience. Mm. So what I've been doing while teaching is, because I've been working both as a designer and as a creative director, I use my hands-on and let's say empirical knowledge. And what I did a lot of times was I kind of was unwinding my own process. So thinking like, okay, this is how I do it. Because if you are experienced, you sometimes can do things very quickly because you've done the steps many times already.
Absolutely.
And sometimes you change a bit. But for myself, it was also a very interesting learning process to kind of unwind that whole thing and trying to see, okay, why do I do this? And maybe also rethink my own process again. So that's the thing I did. And that's how I was teaching my students step by step to give an example of this unwinding procedure, or how you can learn from experience. What I have learned while teaching, and that's what I also tell my students, is that in order to get a good idea or a great idea even, that you tend to think like, okay, you have to make cautious steps, and every time I do it a bit better, and slowly it develops into something like a fine idea. But what I have learned is that sometimes you have to jump for something quite extreme and then make steps back instead of steps forward. And that the first thing is that it's a lot quicker in general. And also you get often to ideas that are more exciting than if you have to do it the logical step-by-step way. And that's what I communicate, what I tell them, what I communicate about with them. And the other thing is that I later on learned that not everyone does it, but I have kind of an analytical mind in the sense that I always observe people and also the people I've been working with over the 30 years. I've worked with many designers in different places and shoulder to shoulder sometimes, right? If you have to do something or with more even. I always have been looking at them and thinking, like, how do you do it? Because they come up with fantastic things that I cannot do. And then I was trying to analyze, like, oh, okay, this is also a way to do it. So sometimes I bring that also into the education process. And what I've, particularly because of China, because language was sometimes a bit of a complication, I was always making digital presentations to kind of show a lot of visuals, also to write what I said as well, so they could have it and spoken, but also written, and sometimes even translated. And that was kind of a way to make more or less sure that everyone was on board. And altogether, I have, like, I don't know, 30 or more stacks of educational material presentations that I use. So yeah, that's kind of the way I do it. So it's very much based on hands-on experience, actually.
Fantastic. Tell us about your latest projects. I think you've also published a book. Tell us a bit more about that.
I've published a book recently. It actually just has come out a couple of weeks ago.
Congratulations.
And the book is, you can say it's a design theory book or a educational book. It's divided in two parts, actually. And it started with the second part, and that is something that was triggered by this void, you could say, of being able to think up ideas as designers in China. I thought, okay, I have to jump into this, so let me think of ways of how to develop ideas. And that, of course, I've never been taught that way. And also what I've learned, because since then I'm always asking designers, like, how do you make ideas? What is your way to make ideas? And I get two answers. Most of the time I get two answers. The first answer is when I'm inspired. And the second answer is when we do brainstorms. Of course, there's also other answers.
Yes.
But this is what generally what comes out of it. And being inspired is a good thing, of course. But the tricky thing about being inspired is that there's not so much control of being inspired, because it's something that happens subconsciously. So you kind of fill your head up with information, knowledge, you find things out, and then you're biking on the street or you're taking a shower, and then all of a sudden there's an idea, and that is fantastic, and nothing against it. But what I was thinking is, can I find ways to speed up the process of how many ideas you can make and also the diversity of it? So that was the first idea of the book. But later on, I thought, okay, I have to embed this into a bigger scheme, because the idea is only a part of the design process. So I actually start the book with focus on mostly that. So it's next to habits and attitudes that can be helpful for designers. It's also about how to do good design research. So I give kind of a, let's say, a format for that, how you then get to conclusions and will be able to write a design brief with kind of a summarization of your findings, but also an ambition in that. And then the creation part, the idea part starts. And that is not so much finding shapes yet, but more an idea or something you can basically say in one or two lines, right? You can formalize it in one line. And after that, you start to find the shape or the form, fine-tuning the design, and then you deliver it. So this is kind of a six-step model, which is not a blueprint, I would say. It's not something that you always have to use that way, but it can be helpful to give some structure and also to detect, like, okay, did I miss something vital? And is that why I'm not getting any further? So do you want me to give some examples of what ways of ideation?
If you like, well, certainly.
Okay, I'll give a few, not all six, because that will be too lengthy, but... One of the ways to come up with ideas is, so it's about mindsets, right? What I tell designers, it's for my students, but I also actually teach this to experienced designers, because I think it can help them too, and they give me the feedback that it does. So one way of thinking is that you have to, you have a given situation and that you change time and change place. It's kind of a way of thinking. And to give an example like that is a visual that many of you probably know. It's the fountain, this ceramic toilet for men hanging on the wall, made by Marcel Duchamp, the Dadaist artist. So he took this toilet and he placed it in a typical environment that is a museum or an exhibition, because you see other works of art, you see these little tags with explanations. It's like completely exhibited like a real piece of art. And that is kind of a good visual metaphor for what you can do. So if you have some object or situation and you change the place where you place this object, then all of a sudden the whole context and the meaning is changing, and that can trigger a strong idea. And the same goes for time, actually. Also, if you have an object that is typical, a historical object, and you place it in today's time or in the future or the other way around, these are all ways to create ideas with. So that is one way. And what I tell my students and also the professionals I'm working with is that you have to slowly, you have to just try and use this method. Some of those will feel familiar to a few and uncomfortable to others, but just by doing it regularly, it becomes part of your mental toolkit, so to say. And then it's kind of easy to turn it on or off. So they probably have, and they're mostly, especially experienced ones, have often ways of making ideas. And I mean, for me, any idea making method is fine as long as it works, right? But this is just to add up onto it.
Absolutely.
And another one I call deconstruct, reconstruct. So it's basically you have an object or a situation or an environment that you take apart, you break it up in all the pieces that is possible, and then you start to rebuild something new out of it with those elements, like a three-dimensional or a visual puzzle. And an example to illustrate this is a book I find really exciting. It's by a Dutch, he's actually a photographer / visual artist. His name is Paul Bogers, and he made a book that he wrote with 250 with sentences of 250 existing books. So he was clipping complete sentences out of a pile of 250 books and recomposing a new story with it. So not characters, not words, but sentences, right? So two steps bigger than what you would normally do. And that is a kind of crazy and very labor-intensive idea, but he also took it to the end. So it took him 15 years to finish it, which is really amazing, I think.
Wow.
I presume he didn't work on it full time. But the good thing is that he also won, he was nominated for a literature prize in Netherlands. So it's not just like a whatever story, it's also like an exciting story. And for type, for people interested in type, what is interesting is that every sentence is still in the original type. So you have one page with like 30 typefaces on it, because he just copied typefaces and pasted them in that way. So that is a typical example of deconstruct, reconstruct. And that is a mental format to produce ideas with.
Fantastic. What is the name of the book?
Yeah, the book is, I have it here.
Brilliant.
It's quite a compact book. It's called How to Make Better Ideas. Connecting the Left and Right Brain in the Design Process. I don't know if you can see it, but the design process is also kind of a little infographic about that process in it. So the book is actually, it's made with the idea in mind that many designers are not necessarily fanatical readers. So it's quite visual. Information is layered in different ways. So there's, on the right-hand page, there's always very compact information, which is a resume of the long read, let's say, on the left hand. And there's also infographics when needed and visual. So it's kind of, it has four layers of information, if you want to. And it started as actually quite a volume, the book, but I took quite some time to try to make it as compact as possible. So it's kind of, so in the end, it's about 130 pages. And you can also read it non-linear, right? You can also just take one part out of it, so you don't have to read it as a story. You can also take bits and pieces from it. So,
fantastic.
I think the feedback so far is that it's quite positive.
Excellent. So if you had a magic wand and you could do whatever you'd like or change or do a change in design education, would you change something?
Yeah, I would think, and that was, I mean, this is also the trigger why I wrote the book, and it all started in the education I was doing in China. I, of course, there's many possible answers to this question, but I would say that my answer is to focus less on making skills and more on ideation skills. Mm-hmm. And I also, if you like, I also can explain why I think it is like that, because in my view, it is easier to learn skills to make things. So the making skills are more easily and quickly learned. Also online, because it's mostly action and routine driven. So don't get me wrong, I'm not saying that designers should not be able to visualize, because uh-huh. they have to. If you want to make ideas, you have to be able to visualize that in some way. And I'm talking about all these things like the Adobe set and all the other technical tools you can learn. I think this is something I would put less emphasis on in design education. And another reason why is because these digital tools will become more and more easy to use over the years, because it's going quite rapidly already. Mm. If you see that a couple of years ago, you had to be an expert to manipulate a visual, like a photograph, for instance, mm-hmm. by knowing the skills of Photoshop. These days, on your phone or your iPhone or with an app, you can just do it while you are on your bike, even almost. It's so easy. So also people with no education in design or no knowledge of design, they can do it. And it's going fast because these days there's artificial intelligence that can manipulate video footage, as we all know, what we call deep fake. Mm. So you can also make someone else say the words that you are saying with the right facial expression and the right words. So this is something that that is a tendency that will make making skills less urgent for designers to know. And I think that ideas are very valuable and always will be needed. So I would transfer more to ideation. And it's a bit similar as what happened with the profession of photography, because when I was starting 25 years ago, you had to go to a professional photographer to get the result you wanted to. And of course, they are still valuable photographers, but there's also many things you now can do with sometimes even your mobile phone or a digital camera you can buy yourself. In the music industry, it's happening as well that DJs are as important as musicians, the people that reprocess music already made. And with artists are equally important as curators, people that kind of create new context for art. And the same thing is happening with design as well. It's a bit behind photography, I would think. But so there will always be a need for good ideas. And of course, you have to be able to visualize them. So I would focus more on that part of design education. And the other thing is that, of course, you also have to know the whole process of the design process. Mm. You have to know what steps are needed to get to good end solutions. And I think it's also important to designers are not strictly educated anymore in one particular specialism, because there was a tendency that we were making silos, because the world after the, let's say, to put it in perspective, after the Industrial Revolution, the world became more complex. And since the digital revolution, it's going only faster. So people are tending to get more and more specialized, but there's no connection between the silos anymore. I think creativity also happens when those specialisms are connecting again.
Absolutely.
And because of AI and because of these tools that will develop rapidly over the next, let's say, 10 years, this will be a lot more easy to do it, I think. Mm. So I'm very much in favor of designers that, let's say, not only study fashion design, but do fashion design and branding, for instance, or maybe even another thing. So they can pick modules they find interesting, and they can kind of custom build their education to their personal interests.
Fantastic.
Does that make sense?
Yeah, of course. What about that link between ideation and making? So realizing the idea. Because you have idea and you have making, but that process of making the idea, what would you say about that?
I mean, for theoretical reasons, I made a hard cut there to say ideation is something that is not visual yet. You describe it like I'm going to make a tool that makes it possible or makes it easy to drink clean water environments where there's no clean water available in a very low-tech way. That's an idea, right? So I've not seen anything. I don't know what it looks like. And then you start to think, like, how do I do this?
Right,
then
right.
You start to, then you have to sketch and to maybe talk with specialists to see, like, how do I build this? What, how can I do it? Actually, the thing I'm describing also exists. It's called Straw. I believe it's this little tube, which is about 30 centimeter long. There's a filter in it, and you can use it with a little ribbon around your neck, and you can just drink from any water you find on the street. It takes all the bacteria, everything out, and you get clean water. It's an amazing product for people that are camping, but also people in situations where there has been an earthquake or whatever. So it's so that's the difference between ideation and visualization or fine-tuning, basically.
Fantastic, fantastic. How can our viewers and listeners find you?
They can find me. They can find me online is, of course, the easiest way. I have a personal website, which is my first and last name connected, joostrozenkrans.com. That's a good start. I'm also only on LinkedIn if it's about socials. So on LinkedIn, also under my own name, Joost Rozenkrans, you can find me. These are, I think, the best places. There's also a website still up and running in China with work. It's called sparkytiger.com. That has more graphic work or more creative work than the one I just released in the Netherlands. So that's the way to do it.
Excellent, excellent. Any advice you'd like to leave us with?
Any advice? What I think is an important quality for designers in general, not just students, but and maybe for everyone, but let's stick to designers, is to stay curious, to stay open-minded. So with the eagerness and the greediness of a journalist or a scientist, right? Mm. And so what I mean by that is that you have a very drive to wanting to know and that you're open to the new. And what I think is very important as well is that you don't judge at a very late stage. So you wait with judgment until you have gone through the whole thing, and that is how you do it. So
fantastic.
Wait with judging.
Fantastic.
What I can say is that people that are younger find it easier to be curious because they have a lot of first-time experiences, right? In the first 20 years of your life, there's a lot of new stuff happening, so that keeps you curious. And the tricky thing is how to stay curious when you grow older. There's, of course, ways how you can do that, I think. For instance, you can travel a lot and see different cultures or connect with people out of your professional zone, that you also know how other people think or act, other people with other interests or professional backgrounds. Or you can deliberately decide to step out of your comfort zone. There's many ways of how you can do it. So my motto, it's also actually in the back of the book. Here it is. It says, if you look very, very closely, everything becomes interesting. So it's kind of a way to urge people to keep their eyes and minds open for what they see on a daily basis.
Fantastic, fantastic. Well, thank you so much for this podcast. It's been fantastic. And hope to see you soon.
Okay, thanks a lot.
Take
it's
care.
Great to speak
Take
with
care.
You.
All the best.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.